a number of years ago, there was a TV series of kind of questionable nature, which took the world by storm. It was called The Game of Thrones. In essence, the story was set in a kind of pseudo-fictional world where a bunch of aristocratic families were trying to take power in the land. The thing I think that really captured people about the story, it wasn't really the magic, it wasn't even the dragons or the fighting, but I think what it was the question about who was going to win in the end, who was going to end up on the throne. You see, the Game of Thrones didn't only have one main character. It didn't even only have two. It had multiple main characters, and any one of them could have ended the show in power. I think the show has brought us up to a point in storytelling in the world where movies don't often have a typical main character, or even maybe just a single main character. The Marvel Cinematic Universe, or the MCU, has multiple main characters in it as well. And then you get movies where if there is only one main character, then this main character is kind of watered down to make them a little bit less obvious of being the main character. We have, for the last 2 weeks, been speaking about doctrine and theology. If you've been here the last 2 weeks, then the quote that I've used the last 2 weeks should be starting to kind of stick. We're doing a series on doctrine and theology because, to quote the podcast called the First Step Theology Podcast, the hosts say, good theology leads to great worship. The last 2 weeks he's spoken about God making it possible for us to get to know him by revealing himself to us through two means, known as general and special revelation. The reason we started with this is because all theology, all doctrine, hangs on this, that God has revealed himself to us. So we're starting to, so this is the kind of the starting block of theology, that God has made himself known. Today we move on to exploring a bit more of the special revelation of God, and specifically how he has revealed himself to us through the scriptures. You see, the struggle that I think many Christians have when we read the Bible is we get confused about who the main character is. And often we make the Bible about ourselves. Now, I'll unpack this a little bit later, but we need to start on one very important point, which is that the Bible always has been, always is, and always will have one main character, and that is God. And so every time we read the Bible, we need to ask, what is this teaching us more about God than about ourselves? So we're going to read today from Psalm 19. We're going to read the whole Psalm. So if you'd like to open up and read along, Psalm 19, not 119, just Psalm 19. Written by David. And it says this: for the director of music, a psalm of David. The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day they pour forth speech. Night after night they reveal knowledge. They have no speech. They use no words. No sound is heard from them. Yet their voice goes out to all the earth. Their words to the ends of the world. In the heavens God has pitched a tent for the sun. It's like a bridegroom coming out of his chamber, like a champion rejoicing to run his course. It rises at one end of the heavens and it makes its circuit to the other. Nothing is deprived of its warmth. The law of the Lord is perfect, refreshing for the soul. The statutes of the Lord are trustworthy, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, giving joy to the heart. The commands of the Lord are radiant, giving light to the eyes. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The decrees of the Lord are firm, and all of them are righteous. They are more precious than gold, than much pure gold. They are sweeter than honey from the honeycomb. By them your servant is warned. In keeping them there is great reward. But who can discern their own errors? Forgive my hidden faults. Keep your servant also from willful sins. May they not rule over me. Then I will be blameless innocent of great transgression. May these words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, Lord, my rock and my redeemer. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. This psalm is a great biblical example of the two types of revelation which we spoke about last week, general and special revelation. Remember, general revelation is how God has revealed himself through creation. So this psalm opens up with that idea, speaking about how the heavens declare God's glory and the skies reveal God's creative hand. Louis Giglio is a pastor from America. He heads up something called Passion, which is probably most well-known for events that are run, and these events are often stadium events. And they run around the world for young men and women to come to know God. They are amazing. And each tour of Passion has a specific talk which is given. So they kind of do a tour around the world, and everywhere they go, Louis Giglio, invariably it's him, does the same talk at every location. Now, a number of years ago, there was a talk called Symphony, and it focused on the praise of God, which is going up from all of creation, and the call for us to join in that praise. Now, I would really encourage you to go and look up on YouTube. Just go Google, you know, Louis Giglio, little bit of a giveaway. You can put next to the word, his name, the word Wales, and you'll find about an 8-minute video clip to watch. And you really should go watch this, because it is a beautiful example of how creation is not only constantly glorifying God, as it says in Psalm 19, but also how it can point us toward God and help us understand his magnitude. Because in this clip, Louis Giglio makes use of sounds of whales and stars and all this stuff to put together so that we can hear what it sounds like when nature is glorifying and praising God, and what it would look like just theoretically for us to join in with that. You see, all of creation is constantly praising God, worshiping its creator, and God has made it like that so that perhaps, to use Paul's word, perhaps sinful people might look at this or listen to the symphony around them and notice a little bit of him. But remember what I have also been saying. The important thing is to remember that general revelation is not enough to save us. It is enough for us to become aware of God and to become aware of our need to worship. But if we truly want to come to know God, to understand him and his heart, to fall in love with the one true God, and to be saved from the grip of sin and death, then we need to read his scripture. General revelation should always lead us to go searching for God in special revelation, because general revelation shows us that God has made himself findable, that we can search for him and we can find him because he first came to us and then gave us his word. The motion of the psalm perfectly captures this idea. Sort of feels a little bit weird with this transition that we find in verse 6 and 7. But if we first look at it from the perspective of revelation, it makes complete sense. Verses 1 to 6 are speaking about God's general revelation, and verse 7 begins the discussion around special revelation. Verse 7 to 10 mentions six things, which is followed by the phrase of the Lord, or as the Hebrews have it, or the Hebrew language has it, of Yahweh, namely the law, the statutes, or the testimony, depending on your translation, the precepts, the commands, the fear, and the decrees. So we're going to briefly unpack each of these six things now. So firstly, the law of the Lord is very clearly the Torah, the first five books of the Old Testament, the books which David, who wrote the psalm, would have heard read to him from the priests in the tabernacle. Remember, at the time of David, there was no temple, so they still had the tabernacle. So David says that this law of the Lord, the law of Yahweh, the Torah, is perfect. Other ways to translate the word perfect is complete or sound or blameless. The law for David is perfect and it refreshes the soul. I think many Christians will find it difficult to understand how, for example, the book of Leviticus can refresh your soul. But that is to throw back to how I open up the sermon, because we have the main character confused. If we read the book of Leviticus with a self-centered glasses on, saying, what is this book saying about me or about myself? Or what is this one verse that I can take and apply to my life? Then yes, it would be difficult to read. But if you read the book of Leviticus with the correct main character in mind, being God, then what we learn is the extent to which God will go to provide a way for his people to approach him. From how from the very beginning he was putting sacrificial systems in place, which would allow people's sins to be forgiven, and how this would kind of culminate or lead toward or point toward the death of Christ. This is how the law of God, the Torah, is perfect and can refresh our souls, because it teaches us about a just God who is also the justifier, filled with love and compassion for his creation. Statutes in the biblical sense are laws and decrees made by God. This is now not the law as in the Torah, but specifically the laws and the decrees contained within the Torah. 613 of these that if you listen to the scholars. David says these are trustworthy and make the simple or the foolish wise. As I said, if you read through the Torah, you'll find 613 laws. And though some of them may, we might think that some of them may be a bit silly or boring. For example, you know, you get one that is repeated three times called do not cook a baby goat in his mother's milk. So you might think it's a bit silly or a bit weird or a bit boring. What I think is because if we read these laws from the main character in mind, we will not understand them. But God is the main character. If we come to understand just how beautiful it is that a transcendent, almighty God guides people in their daily lives down to what happens to when an animal falls in a pit on the Sabbath, then we will fall in love with the Word of God. God loved people so much that he constantly guided them throughout all life. And these laws of God, these statutes, or as some translations might have, these testimonies of God, are trustworthy because they are from God. And they guide the lives of even the most simple people, giving wisdom, godly wisdom, to all. The list of things are like taking a magnifying glass and focusing more and more on something. So we start with a broad Torah. We focus towards the statutes of God that are found in the Torah. Now we focus down even more to talk about the precepts of God. A precept is a general rule which is intended to regulate human behavior or thought. These are naturally contained within the statutes of God. David says that these things are right, that they are good things, and that they actually give joy to the heart. I'm pretty sure it's safe to assume that part of what David was thinking when he was writing this was those laws of God, which shows us how to live our holy lives. Ask most Christians and they will testify that those times when they really focused on living holy lives were joyful times, and their hearts were lighter. Life might not have been easier, but it was joyful because it was a time dedicated to living life the way God intended us to. So now we've spoken about the Torah and the statutes and the precepts. Now we zoom out a little bit more again to go to the broader topics of the commands of God, which David says are radiant, bright, and they give light to our eyes. We, if we are caught in the sinfulness and darkness of life, might find ourselves kind of stumbling around blindly. But God's command lights up our way. It's like Psalm 119 verse 105 says, your word is a lamp to my feet and a light for my path. God's word, which contains his commands, this word lights up our path, showing us where to go and how to live. And as such, we should find ourselves gaining a healthy fear of the Lord, understanding in light of his law and of his word and his general revelation just how big just how majestic he is, and just how small, insignificant, and sinful we are. It is our sinfulness that keeps us from wanting to make the Bible and the gospel about us, when it has always been about God. David goes on, he says that these things of God are more precious than gold and sweeter than honey. God's word guides our lives and shows him to us. Through this, we are shown a life where we are meant to which we are meant to live, and what happens when we don't. It also shows us that by our own strength, it is impossible to see our sin. But in the light of God's word, our sins are made clear and plain to us. And so we ask the only one who can help us in our sinfulness, God, to forgive us, but also to keep us from our sin, so that we don't become so that it doesn't become our master. You see, the story of the Bible is the story of God. It's not about us. When we read the scriptures, the challenge is to not ask what it is saying about me, but rather what is it saying about God. Remember what I said in the first sermon of the series, knowledge of God and knowledge of self are intimately intertwined. The more we learn and understand about God, the more we'll know and understand about ourselves. Most importantly, God's word has shown us that he is a good and loving God, one who never left people, but has become involved in our lives. He is both a transcendent and an immanent God. He's both a mystery and Lord, but also a revealed and my friend. His word shows us this, and as such, his word should be the final rule of faith and life. Amen.